Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who comes. Hallelujah. Come on and worship Him this morning.
Oh, yeah. We worship You, Lord. Yeah.
Come on and lift your voice.
Thank you.
milk never fails, never runs out on us. Come on, amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We want to invite our pastors and our deacons to come forward. We're going to pray for those that need prayer today. So if you come forward at this time, if you need prayer for anything in your life right now and you'd like someone to just agree with you, come on forward right now. Slip out of your seat. Our pastors and our leaders are up here to pray with you. How many of you believe in the power of prayer? Amen. Hallelujah. Just whatever your need is, if you need a healing in your body, if you need God just to, someone just to agree with you in prayer over something, come on forward right now. We'll pray for you right now. Hallelujah. As we go to prayer this morning, Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your presence. We thank you, God, that you're here in a powerful and a mighty way today, Lord. And Lord, we would ask today, God, that, Lord, that your will would be done in all of our lives in Jesus' name. Lord, we're here to do one thing, and that is to worship you and to honor you. Lord, we've come today, Lord, we humble ourselves. And Lord, we pray today, God, thy will be done, Lord, in my life. In Jesus' name we pray. I want you to lay your hand on your heart. Just begin to pray God's will over your own life. Just pray out loud. Dear Jesus, we just thank you, Lord, that we have the awesome privilege to come into a beautiful sanctuary like this and to pray. Lord, we pray that your will shall be done in our lives. As we start this new year, God, that's foremost in our heart, foremost in our mind, that your will shall be done in our lives in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. In the name of the Lord, we thank you, God, for the opportunities that you have given unto us to serve you. Lord, I pray over my mind, God, my mind will be filled, Lord, with your word. I pray over my heart, God, that it would be clean before you in Jesus' name. Lord, that I would walk with you in purity, Lord, in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, today. Hallelujah. That your will shall be. And Lord, we pray this year shall be a year that we shall devote ourselves to you completely and wholly in the name of the Lord. And we do that one day at a time in Jesus' name. I want you to join the hands of those next to you and begin to pray for those. Father, I pray for that one on my right now. I pray your will shall be done in their lives. I pray the health and favor of God over their life. I pray, oh God, your will shall be done in their life. Lord, I pray, God, today for those on my right. I pray for those on my left, oh God, that your hand shall be upon them, Lord. Lord, you said to pray one for another, and we pray for one another today, God. We pray, oh God, that they shall have a great year, Lord, that they shall walk in health, oh God, in the prosperity and the favor of God. I bind evil off their life. I bind any attack of the enemy in Jesus' name, and we loose the power of God upon our lives, Lord, today in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Now lay your hand on your head and pray that your decisions would be right. Father, we pray the decisions we make, Lord, shall be right, and they shall be the ones that you want, God, in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray that today, God. Lord, even this week, God, as we make decisions, God, I pray, God, that you will give us the right thing to do at the right time. In Jesus' name, we thank you for favor, and we thank you for the blessing and the goodness of God in Jesus' name. Now, let's lift a hand to the Lord. I want you to begin to pray for our country. Father, in Jesus' name, we pray for President Obama. We pray for the leaders of our land. God, let this be a year, Lord. Lord, that God, that Lord, there's a move in our government, God. Lord, those that serve, Lord, in the political arena, God, we pray in Jesus' name, Lord, that you'll help them, God. Lord, to call upon you and look to you, God, we pray. Lord, we come against all evil, Lord. We pray over our nation. We pray for those in the military, God, that you'll protect them and bless them and give them favor in all that they do in Jesus' name. And we thank you, God, that you're with them today, God, and you're helping them in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Now let's pray together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us of our sins as we forgive those who've sinned against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Now, Father, I pray there'll be an anointing upon your people today, Lord. An anointing as we enter into this fast, God. Lord, an anointing, God, upon every person, God. Lord, that it won't be extremely hard and difficult, but God, that they will flow, Lord, in this anointing, God, of fasting, Lord. And God, that we will see breakthroughs in our families, breakthroughs in our city, breakthroughs, oh God, Lord, in our nation, breakthroughs in every area of our life in Jesus' name. Lord, we humble ourselves before you today, God. And Lord, I pray the anointing and the favor of God upon every person, Lord, whatever level they participate, God, that your anointing, your blessing shall be upon them today in a powerful and a wonderful way in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a great hand today. Hallelujah. Why don't you turn and greet those around you, say hello to those around you, introduce yourself to them and welcome them today in the house of the Lord. The ushers are going to begin to pass communion at this time, and this is an open communion. We invite everybody to participate today. You don't have to be a member of this church. Hallelujah. Praise God. How many of you have had a great New Year so far? Come on. All right. You're doing all right after 3 or 4 days? Okay. Hallelujah. It's going to be a great year. Everybody say it's going to be a great year. It's going to be our best year yet. Amen. Our best days are ahead of us, aren't they? God's going to do great things in our church, our families. We're believing God for great things. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to read a couple verses of scripture today and call them to your attention. I don't have any great stories like Brother Jones. Nobody can do that. But he's not here today. But I want to share a couple verses of scripture here today with you. In Isaiah 58, how many of you are familiar with Isaiah 58? In verse 11, it says, "The Lord will continually guide you, and he will satisfy your desire in scorched places. He will give strength to your bones, and you will be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters do not fail." Come on, amen? That's a description of those that fast and seek the Lord's presence. And then about 700 years later, Jesus said these words. He said, "Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." Amen? And then in the book of Acts, it talks about how they broke bread daily. Daily in the early church, they broke bread together. It was part of their fellowship. It was part of their communion. So what we're doing today is not something new, of course. It's been going on for many, many, many years. But in the early church, they would meet together and they would do what we're doing. They would break bread and they would remember the Lord until he comes. Amen. And then there's another great passage I love, and it's in Acts 13. Everybody say Acts 13. When you get a chance, look it up and just look that over at the beginning of that chapter. But don't do it during the sermon this morning. And it says in there that they, when they had given themselves to prayer and fasting, it said that's when the Holy Spirit spoke to them. And Paul was sent out on his missionary journeys. Paul had been saved for about 13 years up to that point, and he began the greatest ministry of his life, not right away, not right after he got saved, but 13 years later in Acts chapter 13, the first few verses, and it said the Holy Spirit spoke to them. How many of you want the Holy Spirit to speak to you now? This is the time, church, to hear from God, isn't it? Everybody say, this is my time to hear from God. The Holy Spirit will speak to you and will speak to me also if we humble ourselves and seek his face. Amen. If we've missed someone, would you please just raise your hand? You know, if we missed anyone at all, we don't want to miss anybody. All right, let's pray over this communion today. Father, we thank you for this communion. We thank you, Lord, for your body that was broken, your blood that was shed. And Lord, as we humble ourselves today, God, on this first Sunday of this new year, Lord, we're going to humble ourselves in prayer and fasting to hear from you, to hear from the Holy Spirit, what you would have to speak to us and say to us. And we thank you that we have this awesome privilege, Lord, to take this communion today and to humble ourselves and to hear what you have for us. And we thank you today for this in Jesus' name. Let's eat together. Amen. Let's drink together. Amen. Praise God. If you'd pass your cup over to the closest aisle, they'll collect those at this time. Hallelujah. We're going to go to the screens to ENN. If you direct your attention to the screens right now for our announcements.
Performing Arts Ministries Academy. 14 weeks of private instruction in piano, guitar, bass, drums, voice, and sound. Go to www.pam.cgia.us for more info and to register. Deadline January 8th. The new semester beginning January the 12th. Do you like to sing? Do you want to be part of a growing ministry? Then join the choir at Evangel. If you're interested in dedicating your talent and service to the Lord in 2014, then join us this Thursday, 6 p.m. in Miners Lane Choir Room behind the platform. See Tasha Hatchett or email becky.hoagland@ewpc.us. Are you wondering what you can do with that old car you have? How about donating it? The City of Hope Recovery Center is now accepting cars and light trucks as donations. And remember, these tax-deductible donations help the men of the City of Hope Recovery Center on their road to recovery. Call now, 502-413-0102, and find out more about how you can help the men of the City of Hope Recovery Center.
Too many people are struggling with this subject of money in their relationships, in their marriages. Too many people are struggling with this subject of money in their area of their careers. We just don't know what to do with this whole thing called money. Well, I found out something about money. Money's actually fun if you got some.
The 2014 fast is your opportunity to join with other believers for a time of fasting and prayer. This year's fast will include services you'll want to attend. Week one with Prophet Hank and Brenda Kuhneman.
God says, watch now. The elements of this nation shall once again be marked by the power of my hand. For they will say in not only America, but the earth, why has the soil shaken in this?
Mark your calendar now to attend these services.
Great to see everyone this morning in the house of the Lord. Amen. Are you glad to be in God's house this morning? Amen. Well, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Amen. We just want to welcome each and every one of you. We're so glad to have you. And we especially would like to welcome our guest. If this happens to be your first time with us or possibly first time in a long time, we'd like to acknowledge you. We have a gift we'd like to place in your hand. So if you wouldn't mind to raise your hand, if you're a guest with us this morning, just raise it up real high. Our ushers are going to come right over here. All right, right back over there. Let's give our guest a round of applause. Thank you for coming out and being with us this morning. We appreciate it very, very much, and we know you're going to be greatly blessed. And the ushers have placed a gift bag in your hand, and there's several items in there. And one of those items is a card. If you wouldn't mind to take a moment of your time and fill that out and place it in the offering when we receive it here in just a little bit, we would greatly appreciate that. And thank you so much for coming. We have an information desk right out in our main vestibule area. We'll have one of our pastors there, and they can answer any questions you might have. And we appreciate you for the glory of God. Well, this time I'd like to welcome Pastor Paul Woods to come, and he's going to share with us some exciting events that are taking place.
Thank you, Pastor Dave. Good morning, church. Happy New Year. How's everyone feeling today? You know, when the new year comes, most folks tend to make something they call resolutions, right? New Year's resolutions. Well, what we've learned in America today is that the vast majority of people make New Year's resolutions on three main areas: spiritual, health, and financial. And this church wants to help assist you with all three of those. We're going to be talking about our fast a little later about the spiritual and the health issues. We also want to help you in the financial area. And so as a result of that, we're offering a class called Financial Peace University. You saw an announcement about it earlier on ENN. We actually offered this class last fall, and I wanted to give you a picture or a window of what it was like, and I've got one of our families that came through. This is Kenny and Paula Marshall, and they went through Financial Peace this last fall and had some interesting experiences, so I just want them to share with you a little bit about what it was like for them. So let me ask you this question. What was one of the biggest takeaways that you got from going through that Financial Peace University class, Kenny?
Just trying to get a hold of our credit card debt, and we just got tired of just throwing money out the window and not having a designated area for that money.
Boy, doesn't that sound familiar? I'll tell you what. So what would you say, what were some of the accomplishments that you've already realized just as a result of taking that class for just 9 weeks?
It just was awesome. It, you know, when you can actually see on your budget, and they offer you so many tools on the website, that like the snowball budget, where you take your smallest budget and you eliminate that to you get to your largest, and it just, that money goes to that one. It just, they just give you so many tools. It's so helpful and it's so easy. It's silly, you know, that we didn't see this ourselves.
Yeah. Well, that's it's not silly at all, because it's really not taught anywhere. But we're teaching it now here at this church, so understand. Now, Dave talks about having baby steps, accomplishing baby steps. The first baby step he talks about accomplishing and getting financial peace is getting an emergency fund with $1,000 set up. Did you guys accomplish that in his class?
Yes.
Wow. $1,000 turnaround. Okay. The next baby step is getting a hold of your debt and credit type situations. You'd mentioned to me something about some credit cards that you guys dealt with.
Yeah, this part of the snowball is, you know, we got rid of a couple of credit cards, and the third baby step we're working on right now is the 3 month savings, you know, emergency fund.
Yeah, can you imagine how much peace you would have in your life if you had 3 months worth of living expenses, cash money, sitting in your bank account? I'm telling you, that's what this class teaches people how to do, and the Marshalls are a great example of that, and they're accomplishing it. Let's give them a hand. Thank you for coming this morning. We will have preview classes for Financial Peace University that begin tomorrow evening at 7 o'clock right here at the Belltown Road campus, 6900 Belltown Road here in Louisville. And these classes are open to everyone in the city of Louisville. Friends, family members, people that you know, bring them. We'll also have a preview class this Thursday evening at 6 o'clock at our Miners Lane campus, 5400 Miners Lane. So I want to welcome all of you to come. I want to challenge you to take that resolution about getting financial peace in your house and make that a reality this year. Accomplish that. You can do it. Thank you very much.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Paul. Praise the Lord. Amen. Also, one of the other things, ushers, if you have the cards for the home visits, we want to make sure that everyone here, what we would want to do this year is we want to come to your home, we want to come to your business, one of our pastors, we want to pray over it, we want to bless it, and ask God to move mightily on your behalf. And if you would like this to take place with your business or your home, if you'll raise your hand, our ushers will come and give you a card, and we will collect that from you, we'll set an appointment up with you, and we'll come and bless your home and your business, and I know that God will honor this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Also, I want to let everybody know that during these fasts, we've got some wonderful prayer meetings that are taking place, and they'll be taking place, of course, 6 a.m. at both locations, Miners and Belltown Road, and then we have a 12 p.m. Prayer meeting that takes place at our Miners Lane campus in the prayer chapel. So I want to encourage you to take advantage of that. Come out and pray during this time of fasting, and I know God will meet you in a great way. And then also, many of you are aware that Cheryl Stewart, a longtime staff member here of our church, she's gone on to be with the Lord, and we're having a memorial service for her this Friday here at Belltown at 6 p.m., so we wanted to make you aware of that. A lot of great things taking place. I want to encourage you to keep your bulletin. Go to our website, worldprayercenter.org. We'll keep you updated. Let's give the Lord a big praise clap as our senior pastor, Dr. Bob Rogers, comes. Let's let him know that we love him. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Our fast begins tomorrow. Somebody say amen 3 times. You know, a lot of times when we would talk about fasting, a lot of people would take off on vacation. And, Pastor, we're not going to be here. We would fast. They're lying. We knew it. But the 21-day fast begins tomorrow. We've asked many people, especially if you are in leadership role, to join with us in fasting for 40 days. And however you decide to fast is between you and the Lord. If you fast coffee, that's pretty weak, but God will honor that. We had a man who was a big coffee drinker. He drank more coffee than a lot of people drink water in a day. He was in the military, and he just drank coffee. And he said God spoke to him to fast coffee for 1 year. None of his family was saved. Not even one person was saved except him. And when he went to meet with his family, it was about 7 or 8 months he had been fasting coffee. He said every one of his family came to the Lord. Hallelujah. When that happened, he was so happy, he went and got some more coffee. Hallelujah. But I really believe that this is going to be a time of great miracles, the greatest miracles that we have ever seen. I started my fast actually last Sunday because I'm going to go 40 days. And I don't eat anything on my fast. I don't eat anything. And really, that's the best way to fast. It's a deeper fast. It's a strong fast. And if you think that you're going to get so weak, you're not going to be able to do anything, that's not the truth. We had a man in this church. His name was Dennis Rogers. He was a drill sergeant in the United States Army. And he went on this 21-day fast. He drank water only. I don't know if I could have done exactly what he did, but he went out with those troops. He'd run with those troops. He said by the end of the day, he was shot. But he fasted 21 days totally as a drill sergeant in the Army. At the end of that time at Fort Knox, he was voted the number one drill sergeant at Fort Knox, and they rated him number three in the entire United States Army. He got a big promotion out of that. I think we ought to give the Lord a great big praise clap for that. But tonight, we're going to have a special anointing service. And I know if you're looking for an excuse not to come to church, you'll have an excuse tonight. It's supposed to get bad, but probably that won't happen until late. And you'll have time to come here. The service won't go long, but it'll be great. We'll lay hands on you. I'm going to ask you to bring oil. And when you bring oil, be sure and put your name on it or mark it, because somebody will steal it in the name of Jesus. They'll steal it. They won't feel guilty about it. They'll take it home, and they'll get part of your anointing on your oil. But you say, well, Pastor, I've got some oil. The fact is, I've got some oil. We cook with popcorn and salad. Well, that's cooking oil. I want you to bring some anointing oil. If you have anointing oil from last year, throw it away, because you need a new anointing. There's a fresh anointing that God is going to release. The Lord gave me three promises. One was Isaiah 22:22, that this was going to be the year when God releases the key of David. And the door that God's opened, no man will shut. And the doors that God shut, no man will open. And then in Revelation chapter 3, verse 7, to the church of Philadelphia I write, I give to you the key of David. And the doors that I open, no man will shut. And the doors that I shut, no man will open. And then in the book of Acts, chapter 3, verse 19, it talks about the times of refreshing will come when you repent before the Lord. So this is going to be a time that God's going to open doors, and it's going to bring a refreshing, a blessing in each of our lives. Hallelujah to God. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Now, I'm going to have up here in the front today when we make our march, I'm going to have a journal. This is America Fasting for Revival. It has room for a 40-day journaling. It has in the front of how to journal. A lot of people have never learned how to journal. We use the acrostic SOAP, where you write the scripture for S. Then you write the observation for the O. For the A, it's the application, how it applies to you. And the P is a prayer. And I have these that we want to make available. Also, I have a prayer cloth. Each week, I'm going to give you a different color prayer cloth. This is green. Guess what green stands for? Money. God's blessings. I want you to put this in your pocket. I want you to put it in the visor of your car. I want you to put it in your purse. I want you to put it in a place where you have to touch it. When you touch it, I just want you to begin to declare, yes, this is my time to be blessed. This is my time that God's going to make a way for me. I also have a prayer guide and a proclamation. And every day, if you'll pray through this, I believe God will speak to you. And then we have our magazine, the 21-Day Fasting magazine. You know, I gave one of these to a friend of mine who is the publisher for Charisma Magazine. And I actually grew up with his brother. And so Charisma came out this month with the 21-day fasting and prayer edition. And I read it, and it's not near as good as this one, I promise you right now. But I want to make all these available. They're going to be up here in the front today. When you come and you bring a Seed Faith March, then I want you to pick up this material. If you don't have it, pick it up. You say, well, what should I plant on a daily seed? Well, this is our daily seed. And I bring my tithe, but I also bring a daily seed. And that is between you and the Lord. But if you don't know what to plant, plant a seed of $22 for Isaiah 22. Plant a seed of $58 for Isaiah 58, where it talks about the hundredfold blessing when you give, when you pray, and when you fast. But I also want to make sure that everyone has one of these, Jacob's Vow to Fast. How many got one of these? Hold your hand up if you got one of these. I made this vow when I was 12 years of age. I didn't sign a paper, but I remember my dad preached on Jacob's Vow, how he was leaving. He was almost destitute. His brother wanted to kill him. His dad said, I think it's better that you go away. And he headed towards Laban, Uncle Laban. Uncle Laban lived up close to Iraq in Syria. And I've been that path. They were out in Beersheba, which is out in the desert. And they came along the Dead Sea to the Jordan River. He came around and passed the Sea of Galilee. And then he turned and he went towards Damascus. He went up that road towards Philippi. He went over those mounts where Mount Hermon was. He went down into the valley. It was quite a walk. And on his way, he had that encounter with the Lord, the ladder that went to heaven. And he said, surely this is the place of God. And he called it Bethel. And he made a vow. And he asked God, number one, to honor the promise that he made with Abraham. He said, if you'll bring the promise and you'll keep me just like you promised Abraham, and you'll protect me, you'll be able to bring me back here safely, and you'll give me food to eat and clothes to wear, you'll provide provision for me, and you will give me peace, health and peace. It all is in the same package. He said, I will serve you and I will tithe. It was a vow he made. It was a conditional vow. But all of God's promises are conditional. If we do this, then God will do that. And here's what I'm asking you to do. I'm asking you to take this and put it in your Bible. Nobody's going to see it. I'm not going to see it. You're not turning it into the church. It's something between you and the Lord. But I ask you this year to make a commitment to God to tithe. And if you will tithe, God said he would rebuke the devil off your life. When Abraham tithed, when that became a revelation to him, the next chapter said after these things, after what things? After he tithed. God said to him, he says, what would you have me give you? And he said, Lord, I don't have a son. Everything I've got will go to my servant, Eliezer. And God said, no, you're going to have kids, and they're going to be like the stars in the sky. And God honored him, and that miracle came forth after he started tithing. Not before he tithed, but after he tithed. There are blessings that will come to tithers that won't come to those who don't tithe. And to be quite honest, we'll make it if you don't tithe, but you won't make it. And I want to see you blessed. I want to see God do miracles for you that have never happened before in your life. And those miracles only come to the tither. Can I hear an amen? Amen. So I want you to take one of these. And if you don't have one, if you'll hold your hand up, the ushers will give you one. Ushers, could you bring some of these? And if there's some that didn't get one, I want you to take one. Keep it in your Bible. Sign your name. Put the date down. Fact is, I'm going to sign my name right now. Wouldn't you hate to have a preacher who didn't tithe? One time I had a guy, I don't do it very often, but I check the tithing of my pastors. I don't check it with anybody else in the church, but I do with my pastors. And if they don't tithe, I don't want them around me. Why would I want a thief working for me? And this fella worked for us, and he wasn't tithing. And I called him in. I said, you know, and he gave me all these reasons. I said, well, God bless you. And we had a difficult time. I had to let him go. And so I believe God's people ought to tithe, especially God's preachers. Amen? Now don't give me that excuse your pen doesn't write. My pen does, and I'll loan it to you today. Hallelujah. I mean, I know what you're going to be fasting for. You got specific things you're going to be fasting for. Can I see your hand? Hold your hand up high. I want you to add University of Louisville's football team. We need to be fasting for them. Pray. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. I want us all to stand. Everybody standing. Turn your attention to our screens as we make this pledge, this proclamation. Lord Jesus, I come into your house, not empty-handed, but bringing my tithes and offerings according to Malachi 3:10. The windows of heaven are open to me. Blessings are being poured out that I cannot contain. The devourer's rebuke for my sake. This year is a continuation of the Jubilee blessing. By faith, I have a better job, promotions, raises, bonuses, and benefits, business opportunities, sales and commission increases, inheritances, rebates, settlements, and checks in the mail. I expect favor, interest, royalties, and scholarships, gifts, surprises, and newfound monies. I'm using wisdom and self-control in my spending. My bills are decreasing and my income is increasing. I have the anointing for blessings, equipping me to be a giver for the kingdom of God. All my needs are met and there is no lack. I have power to create wealth. The favor of God's upon me and everything I put my hand to will prosper. I'm a cheerful giver, sowing in good ground that's bringing souls into the kingdom of God, and my God is supplying all my needs. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I want to pray for you today. Place your hand right here on your chest. Father, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke the enemy off of every tither that's here. I pray God's blessings to come upon you. I pray money will chase you down as you drive down the interstate. I pray you'll make money when you sleep, that God will supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And everyone said, amen. God bless you, and you may be seated, and God bless these ushers.
We're going to pause just for a moment. I promise we'll return you to the service here in just a matter of minutes. But I want to remind you that you can call for prayer. The number is on your screen, 888-613-6080. If you're unable to call, you can send it in by email to prayer@worldprayercenter.org. We're believing God to meet you and to meet the need of your life. We serve a God who answers prayer. And he said in his word that we should call on him. We should ask that we would receive, seek that we would find, knock, and the door would be open. So there's many reminders. Make your requests known unto God is another verse in the scripture. So we're asking you to join with us in agreement according to Matthew 18:19. And these partners will pray with you and believe God for your need to be met. So I encourage you to place that call. And let's believe God to do something great and mighty in your life today. Now, we're going to go back into the service, and we're going to believe God for something great. I want to encourage you to open your heart, get your Bible out so you can follow along with the preaching of the Word. And when prayer is lifted up, you join in that prayer. And again, if you need to call, give us a call, 888-613-6080. We're going to go back into the service now as it continues.
Bless us oil today. And if that's some of your oil, stand up where you are. And after church, you can come up and pick it up. But stretch your hand out here towards it. Father, in the name of Jesus, I lay my hands on this oil. We consecrate it to you. Lord, this oil, it represents the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And as this is laid and anointed upon people's bodies, on cars, on homes, I pray for miracles to happen in the name of Jesus, for your glory and for your honor. If you're here and you have diabetes, I want you to stand. Or you have members of your family that have diabetes. The Lord spoke to me that this was going to be a season that God was going to do miracles and healings with diabetes. And God's going to set you free in the name of Jesus. Lord, this is a curse. This is a curse of the enemy. And I rebuke it in the name of the Lord. I rebuke diabetes. I speak healing to your pancreas and to your blood sugar levels. May they be normal in Jesus' name. May you lose the weight that you need to lose if you're overweight. And may God heal you in Jesus' name for his glory and honor. And everybody said, amen. You may be seated. I want to share with you today a revelation that God has given me on fasting. I have studied fasting. I've written books on fasting. But yet I never saw this in the Word of God. And I want you to take your Bible and just hold it to the Lord right now. And I want you to make this proclamation with me. Say, in Jesus' name, I shall hear the Word of God. God's Word, God's revelations will set me free and open my eyes to what God has for me in Jesus' name. I want you to turn with me, please, to the book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter 8. And I want to begin reading in verse 54. 1 Kings 8:54. Would you say that, please? 1 Kings 8:54. This is the story of King Solomon. And Saint King Solomon has built the greatest building that's ever been built on the earth. It is the temple. In the building of this temple, he uses 20 tons of gold. That's not counting the silver. The fact is, they didn't even count the worth of the silver because it was like the stones of the brook. It was so common. But 20 tons of gold, it represents 140 trillion, $381 billion. And actually, it may be more than that with the fluctuation of gold. $140 trillion. To give you an idea of what we're talking about, it would take almost 10 football stadiums to put that kind of money, if it was in cash dollars, just to put it in those football stadiums. And he built that temple. The temple was not a huge coliseum like the Yum Center downtown. It's not as big as, it wouldn't be as big as this auditorium that we're in. But it was so valuable and so mighty, and God enabled him to build that. And so now he comes and he dedicates the temple. And I want you to get the picture how he, what happens. And in verse 54 it says, "And it was so that when Solomon made an end of praying all this prayer and supplication unto the Lord, he arose from where the altar of the Lord was, from kneeling on his knees with his hands spread up to heaven." As you begin to see what happens in this situation, in this great dedication service, it is amazing. It begins actually in the 11th verse is where I want to begin reading. Actually, even before that, it begins in verse 5. And it says this. It says, "And King Solomon and all of the congregation of Israel were assembled unto him and were with him before the ark, sacrificing sheep and oxen that could not even be numbered for the multitudes." You're talking not 10,000 sheep, not 20,000 sacrifices, but hundreds of thousands of sheep and goats and animals were brought in there to sacrifice. The Bible goes on to say there were so many in the sacrifice they couldn't even do it on the altars. But they did it as unto God. And he talks about how he was in this time before God and he entered into prayer and supplication. I want to take just a moment to explain a little bit about prayer. The greatest promises in the Bible are attached to prayer. The Bible says, "All things whatsoever ye ask in prayer believing, ye shall receive," in Matthew 21:22. In Matthew 7:7, it says, "Ask and ye shall receive, seek and ye shall find, knock and the door shall be opened unto you." In Mark chapter 11, verse 24, it says, "Whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe that ye receive them and ye shall have them." In John chapter 14, verse 13, it says, "Whatsoever you shall ask the Father in my name, that will he do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son." In 1 John chapter 5, verse 14, it says, "This is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything in his name, he'll hear us. And if we ask," he says, "that the answer will be there." And so there is great power in prayer. Can I hear an amen? Amen. If a person will just take time every day to pray, you'll begin to see miracles that you've never seen before. The reason people don't see answers to prayer is because they don't pray. Amen. And to pray is to ask. But there are times that there are great concentrations of darkness that come against people. There are times that the enemy rises up against one. As Paul wrote, he said, I face the beasts of Ephesus. Those weren't grizzly bears and lions, but they were demons. They came like animals. They came like beasts that would attack a person. And so he wrote later, he said, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're not fleshly, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. In Ephesians chapter 6, he says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against the rulers of darkness, against spiritual wickedness in high places. He's talking about demons that would come to attack you. There are people in this room that have actually fought against the high-level demonic powers in this city. You have fought against demons that are as strong and as powerful and as tall as the largest buildings in Louisville. And you've prayed, and they have withstood your prayers many times. When that happens, a person must add to their prayers supplication. This is why in Philippians 4:6, it says, in everything through prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And so 60 times supplication is used in the scriptures. But 20 of those times it's used 20% of the time that supplication is used is in the prayer that King Solomon makes. And it's an example prayer. It shows the power of supplication, not just praying, but when your prayers are withstood, when the money doesn't come, when the answers are withheld, God's not in the business of withholding those answers. It's the devil. The Bible says this. It says, for the Lord is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory, and no good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly. God is not going to withhold anything from us, but it's the enemy. Just like Daniel had the angel came to him, he says, it has been the prince of Persia that has withstood you and withheld your answers to your prayer. And so supplication must be added. Supplication is a completely different level of prayer. It is something that involves your entire spirit rising up. You know, I found I can pray driving down the road. I can pray and just be praying and driving and waving and looking and thinking. But supplication takes you to another level. It involves even your physical being. You notice in this prayer, it says, and he arose from his knees and from the raising of his hands. There's a great scripture found in the book of Habakkuk. Somebody say Habakkuk three times. Habakkuk, Habakkuk, Habakkuk. I learned to picture that word as a person who had a backache. But in Habakkuk, the third chapter, it's very interesting. It says this. It says his brightness was like the light, and rays flashed from his hands, and there he veiled his power. There is power when a person lifts their hands to the Lord. The Bible says, lifting up holy hands without wrath and without doubting. I read one time Adolf Hitler, he lifted up his hands and held his hands high for over 7 hours as his troops walked by. That is supernatural, demonic power. He was an occult symbol. He was so full of demons. But when people lift their hands, it's like lightning begins to touch them. But the highest level of supplication is fasting. And in most cases in the Bible where it talks about supplication, it's talking about adding fasting to your prayers. And so a synonym that you could use in most cases is when through prayer and fasting, let your requests be made known unto God. And when you see the word humbling themselves, it's another word for fasting especially in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, the word mourn involves fasting with it. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted, Jesus said. So when we talk about prayer and supplication, you're adding gas. You're adding an explosive formula to your prayers that will break the demonic forces. So when he begins to talk about his prayer and supplication, he's in a posture of supplication. He's down here on his knees. Listen, this is 66 verses. People don't read this chapter because it's too long in the Bible. They get wore out reading it. But if you think it was long in reading it, can you imagine how long it was to pray it? He had his hands raised here, and he begins to pray, and he starts this prayer. And then in verse 11, it says this. It says that while he was praying, the presence of God began to come, so the priest could not stand to minister because of the cloud of the glory of the Lord that filled the house. The people begin to be slain in the spirit. I tell you, it's an amazing thing. People who've never been around that. My wife was raised a good old Southern Baptist. And she came to Evangel. And we had a speaker. And she was home from college. And he began to pray for people. And they began to fall. Right on they just began to be slain in the spirit. She never had seen anything like that. She stood up. She said, are they pushing them down? What is going on here? But how many has ever seen people being slain in the spirit? How many has ever been slain in the spirit? It's the glory of God comes upon a person. Well, no one in that building was able to stand. And so he continues to pray, and then he gets down here in verse 22, and his prayer goes like this. Lord, I've built you this house. Now, David, my father, wanted to build this house, but you wouldn't let him. And so he prepared much of the gold and much of the silver, and I have prepared this house, and today I've brought the Ark of the Covenant into the house. And I ask that your covenant would be established, your word would go forth. And as he's praying this, suddenly in verse 22 it says, and Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of the congregation, and then he spread forth his hands to heaven. Suddenly in verse 22, this prayer takes a different nature. There is a new anointing that comes upon him as he begins to pray, and I believe it's the revelation of the Holy Spirit comes upon him. And he begins to go on in his prayer. In verse 28, he talks about, and show respect unto the prayer of thy servant and to his supplication, O Lord. And he begins to cry in his prayer. It says, a hearken unto my cries and unto the prayer. In verse 30, it says, hearken to the supplication of thy servant. And then this anointing begins to come upon him. And I believe it's the revelation of God. And he says in verse 33, he says, when thy people, Israel, be smitten down before the enemy, because they've sinned against thee and turn from confessing thy name. If they will turn back with prayer and supplication, or if they'll turn back to you with prayer and fasting, is what he's saying, unto thee, then hear them in heaven and forgive the sins of the people. This scripture in verse 33 and 34 was fulfilled almost 300 years later, when Manasseh became the king. Manasseh was the son of Hezekiah. Hezekiah was dying. And he turned his face to the wall and he said, Lord, give me 15 more years. And God honored his prayer. And during that time, Manasseh was born. He became king when he was 12 years of age. And Isaiah the prophet had encouraged Hezekiah, his father, but Manasseh became so rebellious against his own dad and against the teachings of God. The Bible says he sacrificed his own children unto Moloch. He brought idol worship into the temple. And then when the prophets came to him, he had them executed. The fact is, history records that he had Isaiah sawed in half with a saw. So when it talks in the book of Hebrews chapter 11 of those sawed asunder, it refers to Isaiah at the hands of Manasseh. So finally, God just said, I can't deal with this fella. And he sent the Assyrians. The Assyrians were the most cruel, the most vicious of all of the armies in those days. They, according to Chronicles, they led him away with a nose ring in his nose, just like you would lead a bull. And they led him to Nineveh, which was their capital in Iraq. And the Bible says he was put in prison. He was humiliated. And you can read it in 1 Chronicles 33. It says he greatly humbled himself to God. 2 Chronicles 33. He greatly humbled himself to God. Humbling is fasting. To greatly humble yourself was probably a 40-day fast. So he fasts for 40 days, and during this time, God really got his attention. But because he humbled himself, God restored him, and God brought him back to Jerusalem, and he was restored as king. Now, that was a fulfillment of what Solomon had prayed. If the people get wicked, if they turn from you, the enemy comes in and takes them to their capitals, if they will fast and pray, Lord, let them return back to this land. I was preaching in Las Vegas at a Korean church, and there was a fellow there by the name of Kim. Kim had been a gang leader in New York City. His gang was responsible for murders. They were responsible for all type of drug trafficking. And those Korean gangs were really tough. He was arrested. He was sentenced to Sing Sing prison for life. And it was during that time that the prayers of his mother, they were very godly people. They were praying for him that he would get saved. They had prayed for him all of his life. He had rejected those prayers. But while he was in prison, he really came to Christ. And there was a man who came to see him, and he said, now, if you begin to fast and pray, God can turn things around in your life. So the man came back to see him, and Kim said to him, he said, you know, I tried that, and it just didn't work. I prayed as fast as I could. I would just pray fast, and he said, no, I'm not talking about praying fast. I'm talking about not eating, fasting. And he explained to him what fasting was, and so he went on a 21-day fast. The prison officials thought he was on a hunger strike. They put him in the hospital after about 2 weeks, but he continued on that fast for 21 days. He asked God to have mercy on his life. It's real interesting what happened, because God heard that prayer. The prosecutor who was in charge of his case turned out to be corrupt, turned out to be taking bribes, and they went back and went through his ledger on all the cases he had tried during these bribes, and this was one of those involved during this corrupt time, and Kim was released from prison. He came and began to work with Teen Challenge. And he began to go to these different gangs, and he began to witness and started leading many to the Lord. And one night they shot him. They shot him over 5 times. They left him to die. And miraculously, he lived. And so he left Las Vegas, and he went out, or excuse me, left New York to Las Vegas. And there he began to work in a church. Today he pastors over 1,000-member church in Las Vegas. And it was because of the power of humbling themselves through prayer and fasting. I want you to look with me in verse 35. In verse 35, he talks about this. He says, when the heaven is shut up, and there is no rain because they've sinned against thee, if they pray before this place, and he talks about in verse 33, if they pray with fasting towards this place, with supplication, the Lord send the rains. And he goes on to say, and heal their sickness, and reverse the plagues, and reverse the famine. Now, that was fulfilled in the times of Elijah. When Ahab was king, Elijah prayed that it would not rain, and it didn't rain for 3 years. It was during that time that God miraculously took care of him. The Bible says that the ravens brought him meat. Did you know ravens are unclean birds? They're birds that you're not allowed to eat, and yet something unclean was making Elijah gain weight. I mean, when everybody else was starving, he was being blessed. And then God changed his direction. Sometimes the only way God can get our attention is to affect our money. And when your money gets affected, I mean, that's when you really get on your knees sometime. And the ravens quit coming. And the brook dried up. And God said, I've prepared a widow in Zarephath to provide for you there. Well, after this all came to pass, he called and came to Ahab. And you know the big showdown that they had there at Mount Carmel. It was the prophets of Baal versus Elijah. And he had a sacrifice prepared. He covered it with water, poured water, had a ditch dug around it full of water, and fire fell from heaven. And then he went to pray for rain. And the Bible says Ahab went up to eat and Elijah went up to pray. He's on some kind of fast. Ahab's eating and Elijah's praying. And he sees a cloud the size of a man's hand. And he tells Ahab, he said, I hear the sound of an abundance of rain. You know the story how he outran the king's horses and then Jezebel said, I'm going to kill you, and he fled into the desert. And as he's going, an angel came to him. And an angel fed him food to eat. And he said, gather some strength. And then the angel came back, and he fed him again, indicating that he was on a long fast. He had been fasting probably a 40-day period, because when the angel fed him, he couldn't eat very much. Then he came back and he fed him again. Then he continued his fasting all the way to Mount Horeb where God spoke to him. Now, God answered the prayer of Solomon when Elijah prayed and fasted. Notice it didn't come just when he prayed, but it came when he added fasting to his prayers. You know, I remember the story of Cotton Mather. Cotton Mather was one of the great preachers in the early days of the United States. He was a Puritan, and he and his father, there was Cotton and Increase. Actually, Increase was Cotton's son. They actually prayed that thing through in the Salem witch trials. When you see the press, they talk about the Salem witch trials like the Christians went out there and started just killing these witches. There was actually in Europe over 300 witches that were executed and hung and burned in Europe. There was only a few here in the United States, and actually it was Cotton and his son, Increase, that went there and calmed them down. Said, listen, just calm down here. But he was a great man of God, and during the time when King Charles became very angry at the colonies, he announced he was going to send Bloody Kirk, which was one of his generals that had a reputation for going in and just slaughtering anyone who rebelled against the king. said, I'm going to send Bloody Kirk to the colonies. He's going to straighten them out. He went in and began to fast and pray. He said, God, you brought us to this country. This country is dedicated to you. And he spent the whole day in fasting and prayer. It's real interesting. Bloody Kirk never showed up on the shores of America. And on that very day, King Charles died. God honored his prayer. And so, in this case, when Elijah prayed and he fasted, God sent the rain. A number of years ago, I was asked to go out to Beulah, South Dakota, or North Dakota. It's actually north of Bismarck, about 2 hour drive. And when I flew into Bismarck, it was 17 below zero. And I was on the fast, and there was a Church of God minister who met me there, and he said, I've talked to the pastor, and you're here a day early, and I wanted to take you down to the Standing Rock Indian Reservation. And he drove me 2 hours south of Bismarck into South Dakota. And this is a famous Sioux Indian reservation where Sitting Bull was killed. And that reservation in that town had not had rain for 3 years. They introduced me to the mayor, to the county, to the city council. And on that council was the great nephew of Sitting Bull's brother. And it was Sitting Bull's brother who actually killed Custer. And they said he scalped Custer and carried his scalp. And I'm sitting there with his great grandson, and I'm holding on to my hair. Hallelujah. But we began to talk. It hadn't rained for 3 years. And they took me out and they showed me the city reservoir. It was like a lake. They had a dam there. And the water was below where the foundation of that dam was. It was like you could walk down there around that dam. And then it was back a little bit. There was like really just like a couple of some farm ponds. He said, that's all the water we've got. And if we don't have rain, this town will not be in existence this time next year. He said, we read your book on fasting, and we wanted to talk to you. And so I talked to him. I talked to him about Elijah and about fasting and how fasting will bring the rain. And so I encouraged them to get all the churches together. It was a very strong Catholic, a Lutheran. There was a big, strong Methodist group there. And so they called for a day of fasting. They said, we're going to fast until the evening meal. And all the churches had a big rally. They met together. They began to fast. And that was in May of that year when they had, it was a national day of prayer. They fasted. I always wondered what happened. And then I began to see on television the rains that began to come to South Dakota. It rained. And it rained, and it rained. That August, I got in the mail a newspaper, and it had pictures of that town, of that Indian reservation. It showed the reservoir filled to the very top. It hadn't been full to the top like that in years and years and years. They had such a harvest. They said they had never had a harvest of wheat like they had that year. They showed the silos, and they had about four or five silos there with 18-wheelers that would haul the wheat. But then they had wheat stacked that almost was as high as those silos that they couldn't get into the silos. And that's how God honored that prayer when the people fasted and prayed. It's not just prayer, but when there are strong demonic attacks, it's fasting. Fasting must accompany the prayer. I want to read one more instance here in this story. He goes on in verse 45. Then hear thou in heaven their prayer and supplication and maintain their cause. He goes on to say, if they sin against thee and thou be angry, and deliver them unto their enemy, so that they carry them away captives into the land of the enemy, far or near. And it goes on and on and on. And they repent. They repent and come to you with prayer and fasting, or with supplication, which is referring to fasting. Then hear their prayers and return them to their land. Do you remember the story of Daniel? Daniel is the fulfillment of this prayer that Solomon prayed. They were in Babylon. The Bible says in the 9th chapter that Daniel was familiar with the scriptures in Jeremiah that said after 70 years they would return to to Jerusalem. But the 70 years had come and they had not returned. The reason they had not returned is even though they had prayed, they had not fasted. And so the Bible says he entered into prayer and supplication with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. And this is where he prayed the 21 days. Michael came to him and he said, God heard you the first time you prayed, but it has been the prince of Persia that has withheld this prayer from being answered. And God delivered them, and Israel was able to return to the homeland. Can I hear an amen today? But it came through fasting. It came through prayer and through fasting. And I know that God has breakthroughs like we have never seen before in the name of Jesus. Now, for these things to take place, the next 21 days are the most important days of your life. The most important days of your life is not going to be graduation this year. It's not going to be the home that you buy or your vacation you're going to take. But the next 21 days of fasting are going to be the most important times of your life this whole year. Because it's going to set the way. It's going to give you the keys that will unlock every door that you need to be successful and to be blessed. If you don't fast, it's going to be your loss. If you don't set aside these 21 days when everyone else is fasting and praying, if you don't join in on this fast, you'll miss something that will affect you possibly for the rest of your life. Now, what I'm talking about is this. If God answered this prayer of Solomon, God will answer it. If he answered it then, he'll answer it today. And there are these areas. Number one, God will break every demon power in the name of Jesus. That's what happened to Manasseh. He was so full of demons, but God broke it. God set him free. God delivered him. I had a man who was bound with homosexuality. And he came to me and he said, Pastor, I am so bound. I don't know what to do. And I said to him, I said, you need to fast 21 days. He joined us in fasting 21 days. God totally delivered him. He told me years later, he said, when I fasted that 21 days, something happened to me and I've never had that temptation again. Hallelujah to the Lord. Praise God. I had a man who was a counselor, and he was a very good, competent counselor, but he became with a physical problem. He had diabetes, and he could not have any sexual relationship with his wife. And so when he would counsel these different women, he got into sexual conversations with them that led him into a real bad relationship. And his wife left him. He was a credentialed minister. They took his papers from him. And he came to me. He said, I'm losing everything I have. And I said, well, I said, I want you to fast with us for 21 days. For 5 years, he had had an excuse not to fast. There was always, I got diabetes, or, you know, the doctor won't let me do it, and all these kind of things. But that year, he had a reason to do it. Let me tell you what happened. God healed him of diabetes. God healed him of the physical problem of having a relationship with his wife, and God healed his marriage. He's still with his wife today after all those years because of the breakthrough that took place. You know, there's things can get a hold of you. There are demonic spirits can get in your family, can get in your home, can get into children. And sometimes we don't even recognize it. The devil blinds our eyes and we are blinded to the fact of what the enemy's doing. But I'm telling you, God promises, just like Manasseh, God will break those demonic powers. Secondly, God promises during this fast, if you'll fast, he will restore to you prosperity. That's what happened with Elijah. It began to rain again. The prosperity began to come. The Bible says the famine ceased. Amen. And one of the first breakthroughs that takes place when people fast is God blesses them financially. They make more money. There's an increase of God's blessings upon them. Hallelujah to the Lord. It's getting awful quiet here. How many believe God can bless you this year? Hallelujah to the Lord. And then God will return whatever the devil's stolen. How many's had some things stolen from you this year? I tell you, God knows how to return it in Jesus' name. God's going to release keys. Keys of David. God's going to loose to us. God's going to open doors that some of you have never had the opportunity for those doors to open before. God's going to close the wrong doors. And God's going to open the right doors in Jesus' name. A lady came to me, and she's had a job for, a real good job for about 18 years. And she had an opportunity open to her that she's always dreamed about. She's always wanted to have that opportunity, and it's opening this next week. So she came to me and she said, for me to step out and take this opportunity, said it means I'll have to lose my job. I have to resign from 18 years at my job. I'll lose my tenure. I'll lose everything. She said, what do you think I should do? I said, well, I'm not going to make that call. I said, that has to be your call. But I know this, that God has said he's going to give us the key of David. And this is an opportunity that you prayed about, you fasted about, you believed God for, and it's finally come, but it's a step of faith. And I said, you go pray, and you come back to me, and you tell me what God said. So she came to see me in a few days. She said, I really feel that this is God. I really feel like God is opening a door to me that's never been opened to me before. So I prayed with her, and I sent her on her way. And God will do a great miracle for her. And God has given her this opportunity that's never come before. That's what God's going to do for us. He's going to give us opportunities. And sometimes it takes great faith to step through those doors in Jesus' name. But God will meet you for the glory of the Lord. Hallelujah. I want us to stand right now. And I want you to place your hand right here over your heart. And I want to pray for you. Father, I thank you for the power of the Holy Ghost. I can sense the anointing that's here today, that you're going to open the doors of opportunities that the devil has held shut. Devil, you're a liar. You have no right over God's people. You have no right over their children. You have no right to hold them back and to keep them bound in Jesus' name. Lord, I loose money here today. I loose finances during this time of fasting. And during this coming year, I loose the income to increase upon families here in Jesus' name. May your sons and your daughters go to college. May they go with scholarships. I rebuke cancer and diabetes and every disease that would come against you in Jesus' name. I rebuke it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. How many are here today and you specifically need a miracle to happen during this times of 21 days of prayer and fasting? I want you to come right down here to the front. I want to pray for you right now. I want to ask God to meet you and help you. I remember during the time of fasting, there was a lady, I went to see her. And I told her, I said, you know, I haven't seen you in church. And she said, well, Pastor, she said, I feel like I've backslid. I've gotten away from God. And she said, I've just got myself all messed up. And I said, well, I believe that God can turn things around and give you direction and show you what to do during this time of fasting. So she came back to church. And she began to go on this time of fasting, and she fasted for 21 days. At the miracle service, she was there at that fast, and there was a man that had come to that fast. He'd been a part of our fast for 21 days. And I remember talking, and I introduced them. And the next thing I know, they started courting. And the next thing I know, I performed a wedding. Hallelujah. Today, they are some of the most successful people. It's been 20 years ago. They have a beautiful family. They have a beautiful home. God turned absolutely the everything around for both of them. Hallelujah. And behind every good man, there's a better woman. Hallelujah. And behind every great lady, there's a better man. Hallelujah. And God knows how to bring the right ones in. Can I hear an amen? We had a guy that was in our church, and he had this real pretty girl. She had a real pretty girlfriend, and they were going to get married. So he goes on this fast. He fasts for 40 days. And he came off the fast, and he said, Pastor, I'm going to break up with her. I said, man, are you crazy? What's wrong with you? I said, I'm going to go buy you some glasses or something. He said, no. I said, God told me I was to leave her alone. I said, all right. I said, then God's got somebody else. It wasn't 2 months later. Man, he showed up with really a great gal. And I performed that wedding. Today they've got 3 kids. They've been successful. And that gal that he was engaged to turned out to really be a loser. She had, I think she got mental problems. But God showed him all that. Hallelujah. Now, come on, keep praying. I don't want to get in the flesh here. Hallelujah. I want to pray for you. I want you to lift your hands up to the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you to anoint these hands. May it be like fire and lightning touches the hands of these men and these women and these families in the name of Jesus. I speak the anointing of the Holy Ghost to direct you, to guide you, to visit you, to talk with you, to give you revelation that you've never had before. I loose keys to you. There they are. I loose keys to you in the name of Jesus, like you said, the keys of David, that you would open doors that no man could shut, and you would shut doors that no man could open. Devil, you're a liar. You have no rights over the people of God. This is your time, Spence. This is your time, Spence. God's going to do something for you that's mighty this year. Hallelujah. Father, I loose your anointing in the name of Jesus. I loose your voice to speak to your people for the glory of God. I rebuke cancer and diabetes from your family. I rebuke sickness and weakness in Jesus' name. Father, save families. Save sons and daughters. You know, I sense God is going to break sexual addictions and family members in the name of Jesus. Father, I break it in the name of Jesus. I break pornography, homosexuality. I break perversion in the name of Jesus. Come out in Jesus' name. Hallelujah for the glory of God. Now lay your hand right here on your chest. I want you to pray this prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus, this is my year for miracles to happen. Lord, I receive the keys of David, where I will come and acknowledge your presence every day of my life. Lord, these keys shall open doors. Doors to my life. Doors that will bring blessing. Doors that will encourage. Doors that will bless other people. Lord, you're handing me these keys. And I receive them in the name of Jesus for your glory and for your honor. Now I want you to begin to speak the names of your family members to the Lord. Just speak their names out right now. Father, I pray for our families. I pray for my family. I draw a circle about my family. And I come against every demon that's targeted Justin and targeted Jessica and Rachel and Margaret and my grandkids. And I bind you, you devil. You can't have my family. You can't have our daughters. You can't have our sons. You can't have our grandchildren. You can't have our families in the name of Jesus. They belong to God. They're holy to God in Jesus' name. They're holy to us, Lord Jesus. Devil, you can't have them in the name of the Lord. I speak your blessings. I speak your deliverance. I speak your guidance in Jesus' name for the glory of the Lord. Hallelujah. Reach over and touch a person next to you. In the congregation, reach over and touch someone. Father, as we touch one another, may there be peace and love and strength that begins to flow through this church. I come against any fight and bickering and strife. I rebuke it in the name of the Lord. You said where there is strife and debate, there's every evil work. I rebuke that off of you in Jesus' name. May peace be in your life. May peace be in your home and your children. May peace be in your family. May peace be at your work. May peace be in your marriage in Jesus' name. I speak peace to your life. Hallelujah for the glory of the Lord. Now let's continue this prayer. Say, Lord Jesus, remove from my life anything that would hinder you from meeting me and speaking to me and answering my prayers. Take it out of my life. May you fill me with your love and your peace in Jesus' name. Now pray with me. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us of our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's give the Lord a great big praise clap. Hallelujah. You know, I told my grandson, Landon, I said, Landon, I'm fasting this time, and I want you to fast with us. And he said, well, I'm going to fast candy. I said, well, you need to fast candy. And so after about 2 days, he said, Dad, I believe I'm going to break my fast. I said, no, you're not either. Praise God. Now, I want to share this, and we're going to dismiss. You're in a fasting church, and I know you like to eat. We all like to eat. But there's a time to eat, and there's a time to fast. And if you get in this fast and you just cannot do it, well, eat something and start fast. Keep fasting. You know, just keep fasting. You just don't give up. You just keep going. And God will help you. And I'm your best friend during this time of fast. Now, if you stay home, watch television, 99% of the commercials are food commercials. And so come to these services. Now, let me tell you, this week, on Monday night, we're not the Kuhnemans. He's one of the greatest prophets in the earth right now. He is powerful. He and his wife, they're going to be here Tuesday and Wednesday. They're not going to be here tomorrow night. And I know it's going to be chilly, but I'm going to be here. We're not going to be dismissing church. And if you don't want to come, then you're going to miss it. But I've invited 5 of our lay people, none of them are preachers, to preach tomorrow. And they're going to preach the acrostic Jesus. And I'm giving them 5 minutes, which means I probably have to ring a bell because a lot of them can't get stopped. But I'm giving them, they'll preach it, and we're going to pray, and God's going to meet you. It won't be a long service, but it'll be a great service. Now, I know the national championship football is tomorrow night, but I know none of you like Florida State or Auburn, except, you know, that's except.